going to actually, and I'm going to need to do this anyway, because I want to compare the uncorrected standard errors with the corrected ones. So if you don't know what I'm doing right now, it's because I'm just going through it quickly, because I've done it in another series of videos called Multiple Regression Analysis. I just want to get the name of the variables that are included in the final analysis, which was a stepwise multiple regression. And I'm pretty sure I know what they are. I just want to get the unbiased errors anyway. So my dependent variable is AFI. I've just done an ordinary multiple regression, and it's found AFI is my dependent variable. And then these are my independent variables, DJW ARG, AMH DUI, and CIN. All right, so these, based on the regular plain Jane multiple regression analysis done in SPSS, these were found to be my statistically significant contributors to multiple regression equation trying to predict the dependent variable AFI. Now, the problem I have is that I know that I've got statistically significant heteroscedasticity, which was demonstrated in another video. And so I'm not sure if I can be confident that the statistical significance associated with these beta weights are in fact going to remain statistically significant once I correct or adjust the standard errors to be heteroscedasticity consistent using the Andew F. Hayes syntax. So now that I've got this inputted, the constant equal 1, that means to include the constant. Method equals 3, I think you should probably just use that at a default. Method 3 is apparently one of the better methods to use, particularly in smaller sample sizes, and if you have non-normal heteroscedasticity in terms of the residuals. So I think 3 might work well as a default in most cases. The covariance matrix, this produces the adjusted covariance matrix to calculate the standard errors. I don't think it's terribly informative in an applied context. And then it says test equal 1. And if you read the Andew F. Hayes paper or one of his websites, he talks about you should have that equal to either 1 or at least 1 less than the number of independent variables in analysis. To be honest, I've run this several times using different alternatives, and it doesn't change anything. I've even run it without including this term, and it seems to run all right. But I think if you just have test equal 1 as your default, it should be fine in almost every case. All right, so I'm going to run this syntax. It's going to call up the macro to produce new results. And what it produces is the model fit for the inclusion of the 5 independent variables, and it produces an R squared of 0.8218. This is not corrected. This is the same output you would get in the normal regression analysis. In fact, I can show that up here, that the R squared is equal 0.822, and that's just the regular way of doing it, and it's the same thing here. So that's redundant information if you've already run the regression analysis. And the key information here is the standard errors that are heteroscedasticity consistent. So if we look at the constant, the coefficient of negative, now let's look at the beta weight instead. We've got the unstandard beta weight of negative 0.32 rounded, and then the standard error of 0.052. But if you look at the output up here, the standard error was estimated at 0.045 for the same independent variable. The coefficients themselves are going to stay the same. It's the standard errors that are re-estimated using the robust technique. So it does change. 0.045 is smaller than 0.052, and it doesn't have implications for the p-value, at least at the fourth decimal place. But we can see that for CIN, the standard error is 0.081, and the statistical significance is now 0.02. But in the non-heteroscedasticity consistent standard errors, the standard error was 0.064, and for significance of 0.004. So the significance changed quite a bit there for the CIN variable. It went from 0.004, and it was bumped up to 0.02. That's a big change. So you can see that in some applied cases, you would get different conclusions. You'd probably exclude some independent variables based on the heteroscedasticity consistent standard errors. I think it could have real implications, people including variables that should not be included. And I should note that the heteroscedasticity present in these data is really not that big. It's not huge, very, very problematic heteroscedasticity. I would probably say it's moderate heteroscedasticity, but it's had some, you know, it's bumped up the p-value. So if you have a p-value that's just barely making it in your normal regression, once you correct for heteroscedasticity, chances are it won't be significant anymore. And one thing I'll end on is that in the Andew F. Hayes paper, that it was written that because you don't really lose much power by using heteroscedasticity consistent standard errors, maybe we should just use it all the time. Because if you don't have any heteroscedasticity present, then you'll just get the regular estimated standard errors. And as you have progressively worse and worse heteroscedasticity, then it will adjust the standard errors accordingly. And I think that was a cogent argument. Why shouldn't we just keep using heteroscedasticity consistent standard errors? Because in all likelihood, there'll be at least a little bit of heteroscedasticity in your data. I wouldn't hold my breath that SPSS isn't going to include this as a default anytime soon. So I suspect we're going to be stuck with using these macros, which isn't terribly difficult. Thank you for listening.